Hi guys, today we are discussing one of the most frequently repeated questions in orthopedic trauma question paper, the scaphoid fracture and its complications. We will be covering it as two videos, the first one dealing with the scaphoid fracture and another video dealing with the complications of scaphoid and its management. So in this video, we are going to deal with the scaphoid fracture proper. So let's go into the video. To start off, we will see the headings for any trauma case. We have anatomy and blood supply, mechanism of injury, clinical features, investigations, mainly x-ray findings, classification, treatment, and complications. For any trauma question, make it a habit to answer under these headings so that your answer looks structured and you will also not be missing out on any important points. First, we come to the anatomy of scaphoid. Scaphoid bone is also called navicular, and it forms the link between the proximal and distal carpal rows. Scaphoid fracture constitutes 60 to 70% of carpal bone fractures, which is a big number, hence it's important in the exam point of view. The articular cartilage is important because it covers 80% of the scaphoid surface, and only a narrow area of the neck or even a smaller area in the distal portion is accessible to blood vessels. To mention scaphoid's bony relations, distally it articulates with the trapezium and trapezoid in a gliding motion. On the ulnar side, it articulates distally with the capitate and proximally with the lunate. Proximally, its large biconvex surface allows articulation with the radius. This is the final image showing all the bony relations of the scaphoid. Now, we will deal with the blood supply to the scaphoid. The major blood supply comes from the scaphoid branches of the radial artery entering the dorsal ridge at or just distal to the waist area. It supplies 70 to 80% of the bone, including the entire proximal pole, in a retrograde fashion. I have marked it in bold because that is the key word you should remember about the scaphoid's blood supply. The second group of blood vessels arise from the palmar and superficial palmar branches, again from the radial artery, and enter the distal tubercle, and it supplies the distal 20 to 30% of the bone, including the tuberosity. The point to remember here is that there are no anastomoses between the dorsal and palmar vessels. So, fractures across the scaphoid may destroy blood supply to its proximal part due to its retrograde blood flow, leading to avascular necrosis of the proximal part. This is a simple diagram showing scaphoid bone, where you can see the branches from the superficial palmar arch supplying the distal part and branches of the dorsal carpal branch of radial artery, which supplies the proximal part in a retrograde fashion. Next, we will see the mechanisms of injury. There are two possible mechanisms. The first one is compression injury, which results in a more longitudinal load or impaction of the wrist, and so it results in a non-displaced fracture. The second mechanism is hyperextension bending injury, where tensile forces are generated palmarly and it results in a displaced fracture. So what are the clinical features? A high index of suspicion is required so that you don't miss a scaphoid fracture in the ER, because there will not be a dramatic limitation of movement or a significant swelling, which are the common pointing factors to a fracture. But there will be tenderness and you should know where to look for it. There will be tenderness in the anatomical snuff box, tenderness on axial compression of the thumb towards the snuff box, over the scaphoid tuberosity, distal to Lister's tubercle, and there will also be pain on forced dorsiflexion. Now we will see the investigations which help in diagnosing scaphoid fractures. The first one is x-ray of the wrist joint, and the recommended views are PA view, lateral view, scaphoid view or the PA view in ulnar deviation, and oblique views. Here you can see the fracture line marked in PA view. This is the lateral view showing fracture line. This is the oblique view, and this is the PA view with ulnar deviation, where we can see the fracture line which may be missed in a routine PA view. Even if the initial films are negative, the same x-ray should be repeated on follow-up. This is because resorption will cause widening of the fracture line and may assist in identification of the fracture. If the second radiographic examination is still equivocal, a technetium bone scan, CT or MRI of the wrist is recommended. Remember that the bone scan is the most sensitive but the least specific in this situation. This is an MRI image showing loss of vascularity of the proximal part of scaphoid following a fracture. Classification of scaphoid fractures. We have the anatomical classification, which is based on the location of the fracture line. 65% fractures occur through the mid portion of the waist, 25% through the proximal part, and 10% in the distal part. Then you can have tubercle fractures and the distal articular surface fractures or the osteochondral fractures. Based on the time since injury, we have acute fracture, which is less than 3 weeks old, delayed union, where fracture has not united in 4 to 6 months, and non-union, when there is no union even after 6 months. However, many clinicians diagnose non-union regardless of the time period if bone resorption, cyst formation, or sclerosis is present. Next, we have the Rousset classification. Here, based on the direction of fracture, there is horizontal oblique, transverse, and vertical oblique. With that, we come to Herbert classification. This is a tricky classification. So first, I have broken it down into a table, and then we can go into the figure. Type A is acute stable fracture, which is subdivided into A1, a tubercle fracture, and A2, which is a non-displaced waist crack. Type B is acute unstable fracture, which is subdivided into B1, which is oblique fracture in the distal third of the scaphoid, B2, which is a displaced fracture through the waist, B3, which is a proximal pole fracture, and B4, which is a transscaphoid perilunate fracture dislocation. Type C is delayed union, and type D is established non-union, which is again subdivided into D1 as fibrous non-union and D2 as pseudoarthrosis. Now we will see the figure. We have A1, a tubercle fracture, and A2, an incomplete fracture through the waist. Both of these are stable. B1, which is an oblique fracture in the distal third of the scaphoid, B2, which is a displaced fracture through the waist, B3, which is a proximal pole fracture, and B4, which is a transscaphoid perilunate fracture dislocation. Type C is delayed union, D1 is fibrous non-union, D2 is pseudoarthrosis. So, what exactly is a stable and unstable fracture? The stability of a fracture depends on the displacement. So, a displaced or unstable fracture is characterized by a fracture gap more than 1 mm, a scaphoid lunate angle more than 60 degrees. The scaphoid lunate angle is the angle between the longitudinal axis of the scaphoid and lunate, as you can see here. The normal scaphoid lunate angle is 30 to 60 degrees. Next is the capital lunate angle, measuring more than 30 degrees. The normal capital lunate angle shown here, the value is less than 30 degrees normally. Finally, we have intrascaphoid angle in AP view measuring more than 35 degrees and in lateral view more than 45 degrees. So these are the criteria to describe a fracture as unstable. With that, we come to the treatment options for scaphoid fracture. For an undisplaced, that is a stable fracture, the current recommendation is to use a short-arm thumb spica with the thumb interphalangeal joint free and the wrist placed in radial deviation as shown in the figure. A long-arm cast is recommended for non-displaced proximal pole fractures. Prognosis is excellent in undisplaced stable fractures. Consider changing the cast every 10 to 14 days for the first 6 weeks so that it remains firm around the forearm muscles and the wrist. The time taken for fracture to unite depends on the location of the fracture line. A distal third fracture heals in 6 to 8 weeks, while the middle third fracture unites in 8 to 12 weeks, but the proximal third fracture will take 12 to 24 weeks. Removal of the cast should not occur until union has been documented on a CT. Now, about the indications for surgery in scaphoid fractures. We have displaced acute fracture, a delayed union or a non-union when bone grafting is required, scaphoid fractures associated with perilunate fracture or dislocation, scaphoid fractures associated with ligamentous injury. But keep in mind that even non-displaced fracture may be surgically treated if the patient will not tolerate prolonged cast immobilization. For example, professional athletes and manual laborers. Various devices can be used for the fixation of scaphoid. KYS can be used because of their ease of insertion, but the downside is lesser stability and lack of compression. Herbert screws, which are headless, cannulated, multi-pitch screws, are also used. Their characteristic, as you can see in the picture, is differential pitch between the leading and trailing end, which produces a lag effect and provides interfragmentary compression. But their problem is difficult insertion. This figure shows a specific jig used for the insertion of Herbert screw. The fragments are held reduced in the jig, a hole is drilled as shown in the figure, and screw is placed. These are the different types of screws used: Herbert screw, Herbert Whipple cannulated screw, AccuTrack screw, and twin fix two-part variable screw. AccuTrack screw is a fully threaded screw with differential pitch, and it can be used in place of a Herbert screw for providing interfragmentary compression. Now coming to the management of each type of fracture based on the location of the fracture line. Proximal pole fractures are very challenging because they are often difficult to heal. A prolonged immobilization in a well-molded long arm cast may be required even exceeding 9 months. So there is increasing favor to proceed to ORIF. A dorsal approach allows direct visualization of the fracture. Alternately, one may use a Herbert screw in a retrograde fashion also. Fractures through the middle third are the most common, and for a fresh, stable fractures, short-arm thumb spiker cast will serve the purpose. But for a displaced fracture, ORIF through volar approach with KYS or screws is advocated. A distal pole fracture are usually avulsion injuries of the tuberosity and can be expected to heal promptly with conservative management. Undisplaced fracture should heal in 4 to 8 weeks in a cast. A displaced fracture needs ORIF. After achieving a rigid fixation, there is a big controversy about the need for immobilization. Some authors recommend a long arm cast for 2 to 3 weeks even after K-wire or compression screw fixation. But new literature is in favor of early mobilization. Now, I am just mentioning the complications of scaphoid fracture. We will see them in detail in a separate video because complications of scaphoid fracture in itself is a question for you. So what are the complications? We have delayed union, malunion, non-union, avascular necrosis. Remember, avascular necrosis of the proximal one-third scaphoid will occur usually in 15 to 40% cases. Finally, we have osteoarthritis of the radiocarpal or intercarpal joint, which is what we commonly call as SNAC or scaphoid non-union advanced collapse. Now, let us have a quick recap of the points we have seen using a spider diagram. First of all, the headings, because it's a trauma case. In anatomy, the other name for scaphoid is navicular. It constitutes 60 to 70% of carpal bone fractures. 80% is covered by articular cartilage, hence poor blood supply, bony relations, and remember, retrograde blood flow from the dorsal branch of radial artery. There are two mechanisms of injury, compression injury and hyperextension bending injury. In clinical features, we have to look for tenderness, especially in the anatomical snuff box, scaphoid tuberosity, plus there will be pain on forced dorsiflexion. Under investigations, remember PA view with ulnar deviation and the importance of repeat X-ray. Other tests are MRI and bone scan. The classifications here are Herbert, Rousset, anatomical, and classification based on the time since injury. In Herbert, we have type A as acute stable, type B as acute unstable, type C as delayed union, and type D as established non-union. Rousset is based on the direction of fracture line as horizontal oblique, transverse, and vertical oblique. About treatment, for an undisplaced fracture, conservative management with short-arm thumb spica, and remember the importance of CT to decide when to remove the cast. For ORIF, the indications and devices used are important. Main indications include a displaced fracture, non-union, perilunate fracture dislocation, and in athletes. Devices used are KYS, Herbert screws, and AccuTrack. Finally, the complications, delayed union, malunion, non-union, avascular necrosis, SNAC or osteoarthritis. So, using the previous diagram, we have summarized the whole essay in 2 minutes. This is the concept we will be including in all our videos. Hope the video was useful. Until we meet again, Team Capsules signing off.